here today. I want to recognize a few folks that are attending here representing the federal government. There's Nicole Yates, District Director for Congressman Yarmouth's office. Thank you. And representing our Metro Council is President David James and Keisha Dorsey. So thank you all for being here as well. And all of the officials here from Metro that participated this morning in a pre-session that I'll be talking to you all about. As was announced late yesterday, Jefferson County has its first confirmed case of COVID-19. The patient is currently at Norton Brownsboro Hospital, and we're committed to sharing all the details as we can and as quickly as we can. You'll be hearing more about those here in a second. We do expect to see increasing cases here in Louisville, and we have been preparing for that since January. We're going to continue to monitor the frequency and details of the cases and make decisions as the situation evolves. There's clearly lots of unknowns that will be taking place here over the next couple days and weeks, but we'll continue to communicate strongly. Part of that communication includes coordinating with the state, the governor's office, and the State Department of Public Health. Are in regular and frequent contact, both with our public health department, myself, other officials here at Metro Government. We appreciate that cooperation that's taking place seamlessly here in our Commonwealth. So obviously, it is only natural for people to have lots of questions right now. Some of those questions go into concerns. Unfortunately, we knew it was just a matter of time before the virus came to our city. And what is most important for us right now is for the city and all of our residents to take appropriate steps to keep all of us safe. These are simple steps that we can take as well. We want to emphasize these are the same kind of steps that you'd want to take if we were safeguarding against the flu. So this is not a new thing in terms of public awareness. We just want to really intensify the focus and the efforts on this particular issue because some of the unknowns with COVID-19. For Louisville government, obviously, our number one filter that everything goes through is how do we keep our citizens safe? How do we keep our citizens protected? And obviously, a public health challenge like this is one of those situations. So we have been planning and preparing and working seamlessly together, both as the departments within Metro government, with the state, with our companies, with our hospitals here in the city of Louisville. This morning, my senior leadership team, there were about 50 or 60 of us over here, reviewed our protocols and procedures to ensure that we will keep Louisvillians safe in an individual capacity, but also in a community-wide capacity. So it's really the community gatherings that we really want to be focusing on and having people think about where they're going, what shape that they're in, should they be going to stop or limit any potential of community spread. So some of the things that we discussed this morning are just in general, we want people to be thinking about cleaning their facilities, high-use facilities in particular. For example, for us, that would be our libraries that have quite a bit of public going in and out of them, or the courthouse is an example. That same type of practice, every company, every church, place of worship should also be thinking about that. Our public safety teams have updated and shared pandemic preparedness plans. An example of that, EMS and the ambulances will be doing a pre-screen for callers to help determine the level of equipment needed to respond. And then if someone gets in an ambulance that has a suspected condition of COVID-19, there will be an ambulance cleaning that takes place and certainly a post-shift ambulance cleaning that takes place for all of our disinfectant opportunities. We're also working on alternate plans to evaluate programs where high-risk populations gather. And we want to make sure that everybody also thinks about, you know, not all gatherings are the same, right? You can have tens of thousands of people in close proximity inside, or you can have hundreds of people not in close proximity outside. So we want to make sure we exercise common sense and ask people to do so as we evaluate different gatherings. All of our agencies have updated their standard operating procedures and cross-trained to ensure knowledge and best practices going on within Metro government. We're going to keep briefing the media every day as needed to provide updates and guidance. And finally, just remember the simple but powerful steps they're going to be mentioning today. That'll be a test for us as a community when everybody can say, here are the steps that we need to take. What is step number one to decrease COVID-19? Wash your hands. Very good. For how long should we wash the hands?
20 seconds.
20 seconds. All right, so have a little jingle. Sing happy birthday twice or something like that. With warm water and soap is the best way to do it. And then avoid touching your eyes, nose, and mouth. Cough or sneeze into your elbow or a tissue and throw the tissue away. Try to, instead of handshaking right now, no, go for the elbow bump. All right? Everybody's getting used to that real quick. And then if you have questions, please call the Kentucky Coronavirus Hotline at 800-722-5725. We're now going to go through a series of speakers, and first up is the Director of Public Health and the Chief Health Strategist for the city, Dr. Sarah Moyer. Doc?
Morning, everyone. So I wanted to start by emphasizing that just like we did for hepatitis A, we are committed to giving you all the information that you need as soon as we can. So late yesterday, things happened very fast, and we only had a little bit of information available to us. What we know as of now is that our first confirmed case is an adult who had recently traveled. Norrin's shared that this patient is in their facility, is in isolation, and is in stable condition. What's happening now from a public health standpoint is that our communicable disease nurses and epidemiologists are working with this patient to learn where they've been around, what they've and been retracing their steps on a day-by-day basis. This way we can learn who may have been exposed and work with them to take necessary action. So as I said yesterday, I want to repeat, if the health department calls you, please answer and be honest in answering our questions. This will help us keep our community safe. Right now, we have no evidence of community spread, but we are expecting that it's only a matter of time that there will be. So the ways we can limit and stop the spread of coronavirus are first and foremost, like we heard the mayor mention, practice good hygiene. I know you're getting tired of us hearing us emphasize this, but it works. It protects the spread of germs and protects you from ingesting the germs that make you sick. And we know from studies that only 4 in 10 people wash their hands after going to the restroom, and only 5% do it correctly. So please start practicing now, washing your hands. And then we do know the people that are highest risk of getting seriously ill are those that are over 60 and those with underlying chronic medical conditions. And so right now we are recommending that these people are especially cautious. If you're 60 years and older or have diabetes, heart disease, lung disease, kidney failure, or other chronic major medical conditions, recommending that you avoid densely populated community events and avoid family and friends who may be sick with colds and viruses. We're also advising nursing homes and other long-term care facilities restrict visitors to their facilities and that they consult the state and CDC's website for guidance on this. And we're recommending that businesses start actively planning for telework options appropriate for their situation and support all workers and students to stay home if they are ill. And then lastly, as we know that our healthcare facilities, I want to make sure they do not get overrun. Only go to the emergency department for an illness that would have taken you to the hospital before this outbreak. We still want you to go if it's an emergency, but if you have a runny nose, cough, fever, or other common respiratory infection symptoms, take Tylenol or Motrin-like products and stay home from work or school until you are fever-free. If you think you need medical care, please contact your healthcare provider and further instructions of what to do. And then if you have questions, please look at our website, the state's website, CDC's website, and if you're not able to find your answer there, the Kentucky Hotline at 1-800-722-5725 is the place to go to get that answered. So just to repeat, the best way to prevent this disease right now is avoiding contact with sick people and staying home if you are sick, avoiding touching your eyes, nose, and mouth, which is actually really hard to do, so start practicing now, coughing and sneezing into an elbow or tissue, and wash your hands. So starting tomorrow, we'll be holding a daily conference call to brief the news media. Please email Dave Langdon, our PIO, at dave.langdon@louisvilleky.gov, and he'll send you the details. So thank you, and turn it back over to the mayor.
Eric Friedlander is no stranger to you all, either from a local government capacity or state government capacity. He's the Director of Health and Human Services at the state. So, Eric, if you'd share some words with us.
Certainly. Thank you. Yeah.
First, for those in Louisville, I just want to say you have a great team. The mayor has assembled a fantastic team here in Metro Louisville. The Department of Public Health and Wellness has a fantastic team, as demonstrated by your response to hepatitis A. So while it was an honor to work for the mayor, it is a relief to be at the state and work with the city of Louisville. We have tremendous folks in place, and our communication, this is why I am here, is to assure everybody in Louisville and in Kentucky that we are communicating the best information we can as quickly as we can. We were on the phone with the mayor and with Norton Hospital within an hour of the first confirmed test, positive test for Louisville. We were talking on Facebook Live within an hour and a half. This is the type of communication we are going to try to give at all times. There's a website, kycovid19.ky.gov. That website is updated all the time. It is updated after all of our press conferences. It has the most recent information about what's going on in the state that's there. Healthcare providers, schools, individuals can go and get information from that website. It is Kentucky specific, and it is also from the CDC. It is the site that we are trying to get everybody to use because that's where the information is. And the reason I say that is over the past several days, of course, we've heard all sorts of rumors on the internet that almost all were false. So please don't get your news from there. Go to the website and get your news from that site. We will give you the most recent and accurate information through that website. And that's why that is so very, very critical. One last thing I want to say. Those with long memories and gray beards, remember, we've had the bird flu. We've had H1N1. We've had SARS. We've had all sorts of things that have been communicable diseases that have gone through and gotten everybody worried and scared. This is another one of those, right? But we will get through this. Mostly, for most people, these are very mild symptoms. Very mild. Mild symptoms. So we will get through this. We've seen this before. You heard Dr. Moyer talk about when the health department calls you. That's what they're doing. They're tracing contacts. We do this all the time. This is not something new. This is something that we're prepared to do. And so I want to reassure everyone watching this that this is something that we are prepared for. We've been preparing for this now for months. And in honesty, we've been preparing for this for years. Thank you.
Thank you, Eric. JCPS, Dr. Marty Polio, and his great leadership role there. What's happening?
Thank you, Mayor. And we are glad to be working alongside of all of the city agencies, state agencies, and partners. And we've been, for the past several weeks, in close communication with Metro Health. And really working for the best interests of our students and staff. So we want to thank the health department for all they've done to assist us in our planning in JCPS. We've been in continued conversations with them to follow their guidance to make sure we are taking all necessary precautions. The spread of coronavirus is something we've been monitoring closely, and clear guidance has been given to our principals and school building leaders about actionable steps that can be taken right now to reduce the spread of any virus, including the flu. So principals and administrators are ensuring that custodial staff are doubling down on their efforts, as was advised by the mayor and what the city is doing as well, to make sure our buildings are clean and disinfected. The additional precautionary measures, we've sent information to all schools, parents and guardians regarding coronavirus symptoms, along with proper hand washing and cough etiquette. And we are having our students watch videos about that this week. Our pandemic viral event plan, which is very thorough, was implemented earlier. We shared a summary of that plan with our families this weekend. And right now we are on a level 5 in JCPS as a part of our plan. And that makes that we are keeping a close eye, clearly, on absences in all of our schools. Local field trips are currently happening for our students. We're evaluating out-of-county field trips on a daily basis. And we have already told our principals to consult with their assistant superintendents and cabinet members if there is any out of county travel planned at this time. We will continue to work with the health department on the guidance around this matter. And so we will continue to have school at this time. Kentucky health, public health officials are not recommending school closures at this time, but we do monitor that daily. If that changes and we are advised to close school by health professionals, we have educational materials that will be available to students in their digital backpacks. Paper copies will be distributed to students so that we can provide that ongoing assistance to students and families if that were to happen. These will be supplemental items that are project-based, hands-on for students in the event that school does have to close. But once again, at this time, we will continue to have school. This is a developing situation that we monitor throughout the day, and we know parents will continue to have questions. So we'll give updates on our website. I would encourage all parents and families, once again, to go to the state website. But we will also keep our website updated by getting information from the state's website that will address any questions or concerns. And as always, our focus is on safety, and we will continue to ensure that focus remains that way. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Polio. Next up is Dr. Jason Smith from the University of Louisville.
Thank you, sir. So I want to thank everybody and for the opportunity to be here. One of the things I wanted to reiterate from the University of Louisville standpoint and University of Louisville Health is that the Center for Excellence in Research in Infectious Disease, as well as our Center for Preventative Medicine at the University of Louisville, have been working with the CDC since the beginning of January in helping to develop tests, trying to identify and isolate the virus for possible vaccines and treatment further on down the road. We've been working with them hand in hand, and we hope that that research and that ability that we have will offer not just University of Louisville Health, but all the healthcare organizations within our community the opportunity to benefit from what we have and what we've been able to provide as far as information is concerned. I would also like to reiterate what everyone has said up here previously. The vast majority of people who contract this disease will not need hospitalization. The vast majority of people who contract this disease will not need to be seen in an emergency department. So if you feel like you have symptoms, please call your primary care provider. They can work with the public health department for identifying the people that need to be tested. If you need or feel that you need to be treated in a hospital, please come to the emergency department. And I dare say that every healthcare system within the city itself has the protocols in place for the management of infectious disease just like this. The things that we need to do as a healthcare system, as well as a community, as far as preventing the transmission of this disease, not just to patients, but also our staff and other visitors in the hospital, are well established. You've heard them here this morning. Washing your hands, making sure you're not touching your face, making sure you keep the facilities clean. And those are things that we do every single day. We're lucky here in Louisville. We have some of the best healthcare providers, bar none, across the entire city. And the systems that we have in place at each one of those give us the confidence that we will be able to meet this challenge and provide excellent health care to all the people within the city of Louisville. So again, thank you very much for the opportunity to speak today.
Thank you, Doc. And last is Russ Cox, the CEO of Norton Healthcare. They're a tremendous provider of health care for our community. Russ.
Thank you, Mayor. While there's an intense activity taking place in Norton Brownsboro Hospital, it's being done so with a calm confidence that comes from being prepared. We've worked with the mayor's office, we've worked with the governor's office for months in preparation for this, so now it becomes a matter of executing on that preparation. Just to echo what so many people have said here, last night, within 1 hour of a test of one of our patients at Norton Brownsboro Hospital being confirmed as COVID-19 positive, I had a conversation with Governor Beshear and Mayor Fisher. We immediately began to execute the plan that we had prepared for, but it couldn't have happened without the coordination and the communication that took place immediately. Building on that today, we've already met with officials from Harrison County. We've already met with officials from Fayette County, where there are COVID-19 positive patients. We do know the trends and tendencies that are taking place with them. We are sharing information. One of the beauties of healthcare providers in this state is that when it comes to public health, we know no competition. The only thing we know is public health and the benefit of the public. So we will continue to work together. We will continue to share information. And we will continue to do the good job that is expected of everyone who is in healthcare. Our patient is at Norton Brownsboro Hospital. That patient is in isolation. We are right now in the midst of identifying any employer, any caregivers, employees who had interactions with the patient. We're also looking at anyone in the public who may have had interactions with this individual. We continue to work with the mayor's office to identify those people. We continue to look at our records to make sure that we reach out to as many people as is necessary to make sure that they know that they could have been involved in this and that we get them in and evaluate them at that time. So we're very pleased that we were prepared. We recognize that this is very fluid. We'll have to continue to be prepared, and we'll have to continue to execute on that plan. But we know that all the agencies are working together, and that's what will get us through this. So thank you very much.
All right, just a couple of things before we take any questions. One is, I really want to ask, and I'd like for the media to assist with this, is if all of our businesses and places where people gather, nonprofits, places of worship, could go to LouisvilleKY.gov and download this bulletin. Okay, and so the more we see this bulletin around the community, the more people are going to be reminded of the common sense steps that we're asking each and every one of them to take. So you all through the media can really help us with this. And so this is a request I'm making to all businesses in any place where multiple people gather. Please download this from LouisvilleKY.gov and post this prominently throughout your facility. Okay. Tomorrow, we're going to be meeting with community partners and stakeholders to provide the latest information and talk about our ongoing coordination with the external partners. So that's another meeting tomorrow, and we'll brief you all after that. And then later this week, we'll hold another preparedness exercise to ensure we've covered all of our bases as we work through this situation together and do some different simulations to think about different contingencies. So y'all can expect to be included in all of those. And now I welcome your questions.
What is the current condition of the patient at Norton?
Current condition of the patient at Norton Brownsboro Hospital is stable. Please bear with me. We have HIPAA and patient privacy where we can't get beyond that as it relates to the condition of the patient, but right now, stable.
Can you tell us how this patient came to the hospital? Was this an ER patient?
We're not able to discuss the specifics of that at this time.
Can you tell us what symptoms this patient presented?
Respiratory primarily. Again, I can't get into that specific.
Mr. Mayor, is anything being done to address populations, people like in the local jail, people in homeless shelters, those sorts of folks who live in very close proximity? Is anything being done to ensure that that doesn't become an epicenter of an outbreak?
Yes, and can you speak directly to that? I mean, yes, there are, and Dr. Moore has more detail.
So, yeah, that was part of our briefing meeting this morning, just discussing all the protocols they have in place. So not just, it's a similar stuff that we do for the flu every year and what we did with hepatitis A, but yes, they all have procedures in place right now.
Can you give us an idea as to what those protocols are?
I guess you check the guidance is all up on our website of what they need to download and do, but proper sanitation and other things like that are all part of it. It'll all that combined, it'll depend on the risk to the kids. If we find that there is a risk to the kids and the staff, then that will be when we have that recommendation.
And how do you decide if there's a risk?
There's lots of pieces that go into that puzzle, and it's changing every day.
Can you describe some of those pieces of the puzzle?
I guess. Essentially what you said. So if spread is happening among the kids or there's if that's happening, then that would be all pieces of that puzzle.
What can you tell us about the Omni Hotel and the case that presented after the person attended a conference at the Omni? What's going on in that aftermath, and what else can you tell us?
We've been in touch with the Omni. I know the Omni has been or will be Where's Eric? In touch with the state for the necessary protocol to make sure that the employees there have been safeguarded. Eric, do you have anything more to add to that?
I don't have much to add other than, one individual coming through, there's no evidence of community spread with that individual as far as we know. All those things are being traced not only by the state, but also by the CDC.
What about the Norton patient? Is this a case of community spread, or does that patient fit the profile of someone who was traveling?
I believe we said this morning in Frankfurt that there is one individual that was more of a traveler than others. So that's why I believe you heard us say here we don't, again, without doing the full trace, without doing the full work that the Department of Public Health has to do, it's really not quite possible to say yet. Sorry about that, but that's the best we have.
Yeah, and let me emphasize here, David. So what we're going to be seeing around the country and what we're seeing already is this virus is spreading, right? So for individuals, the question they're going to be asking themselves is, what can I do? And so that's why we continue to reiterate, what you can do is stay away from people that are sick. If you're sick, stay home. Follow these basic practices. Think about this in perspective of the flu. There have been 66 flu deaths in the Commonwealth alone this year and 19,000 reported cases of the flu. So this is a variant of the flu. It's just there's some unknowns to it. So think about that when you're thinking about going about your daily life. Just follow these normal precautions that we continue to emphasize.
Mayor, we're 35, 40 days, give or take, from Thunder and then into the Derby season, the marathon, mini marathon. At what point does the city have to make a decision, kind of a go, no-go, on whether those things stay on the calendar?
Yeah, well, certainly they're all planning to go ahead right now, and so we've got quite a bit of time, and we're all very curious to see, and somewhat anxious, obviously, to see what's going to be taking place with these reported incidences. Are they going to skyrocket? Are they going to incrementally increase? Are they going to start to decrease? So those will all be factors that we take a look at. And, not every event is created equal as well, and by that I mean there's indoor events. There's outdoor events. There's events where people are in close proximity, those where there's not close proximity. So those will be some of the evaluation points we'll take a look at.
As far as Derby, that typically draws a more worldwide audience, this may be a question for Dr. Moyer. Is there any plan to put people at the airport to maybe keep an eye on people that may look borderline-ish as they come into town for particularly Derby?
Well, one of the advantages of that is the Derby's 47 days out from now, so we will be much smarter, not just here locally, but around the country as well. Yesterday, I talked to Mayor Steve Adler in Austin to kind of go through the process that they use to decide South by Southwest cancellation. Unfortunately for them, they're kind of at the front end of figuring out how to handle these mass events. So they didn't have nearly the information that they needed. So to err on the side of caution, that's why they canceled that. We will have much more information by the time the Derby rolls around.
We have time for one more question.
Dr. Cole, what sort of options are available for schools? Are you looking at just potentially closing down individual schools, groups of schools, or is it a system-wide sort of thing?
Well, as we do, which we follow our plan, and that's the most important thing we do, is we will consult with the state health department and the local health department to make those decisions. So I think all of those options could be on the table. It is much more challenging to close a small group of schools, clearly, because then there's a lot of other factors that go into that, including makeup time and things like that. But all the factors, we'll take those into account and just follow our plan, consult with state and local health department to make those decisions.
Thank you.